thanks first to Leo, of course, for introducing me, and second to this whole series. I think it's an excellent idea that you're having this series, and I hear that you are going to put the recorded presentations on some kind of a homepage, which I think is really, really a super idea. So something good is coming out of Corona, surely. Great. I've chosen the title Metal Microstructures in 3D and 4D. And so the talk will be in two parts, really. One part where I am talking about methods, and I will do it a little bit historical so you see the development. And then I will give examples using these techniques for studies of recrystallization. So as Leo said in the introduction, this is my two favorite topics at the moment. So it will be hard for me to restrict myself in time, but I will try to stick to something like 45 minutes. So that'll be good time for questions as well. I cannot see you. So if something happens, then shout. If sometimes the slides are not good or something. But let's start. So when we want to look at the microstructures, I would say right away, microscopy is our most important tool to map them. We can do magic things, going all the way from optical microscopy, looking at the large scale, to scanning microscopy, and to TM. And as we heard in the last lecture, you can combine these methods with, for example, chemical information that you can get from 3D atom probe. And as you all know, you can also combine it with crystallographic information as you can get from the EBSP technique. These, as I say up here, these are the most important tools that we're having. They're very, very important. And adding all this extra information is super important. But when you look at these techniques here, not the 3D atom probe, but all the other techniques on the screen here, an issue could be that they are two-dimensional. So we always have to watch out that we don't end in this situation here, that we come up with wrong conclusions. Still, if you want to go to 3D, you can do a lot based on just 2D measurements, microscopy measurements. You can do serial sectioning, as I kind of sketched here, and therefore get a 3D picture of how the particles are distributed in this aluminium sample. You can look at different sections and therefore get a detailed view of how, in this case, your deformation microstructure is built up. And you can do XY time. So you can take a surface and you can anneal the sample and you can see how this grain that we are having here is growing at various time steps like that and then start to analyze it. Of course, problems here are this is destructive. So you cannot follow what is happening. If you want to see, you are ending up with a pile of dust. Down here, it's essentially all surfaces and you are never sure whether surfaces would give the true picture of what's happening in the bulk. So this was kind of our motivation way back in 1995, almost at the time when Leo and I met each other for the first time. Could we make something non-destructive 3D imaging? And the vision was that we could make a technique like the EBSP technique, which was developed some years before that, where we could map the orientation, crystallographic orientation, to non-destructively in micrometer size local volumes in the bulk of some larger samples. And as always, when it has come to technique development, I think a very good way to do it is that if you have a scientific motivation to do it, you should never develop a technique where you don't really need it for some science or vice versa. So the requirements for making such a technique were kind of three important ones and maybe a number four one. Namely, you need at least micrometer spatial resolution, you need bulk penetration, and it needs to be non-destructive. We also put a focus on fast measurements, because then we could follow some of the processes really in situ. Maybe that's needed, maybe that's not needed. And actually, at the time there, we were lucky, but that was at the time when synchrotrons became, large-scale synchrotrons became kind of standard almost. And they were spreading the type of investigations they were doing. So for us to make this dream come true, was really in three important steps. The first important step was we hired this person that many of you know, Henning Fritz Poulsen. He is a physicist and had a background in high energy physics. He had worked as a postdoc in Hamburg. He originally also came from research, but he worked in Hamburg as a postdoc on this X-ray optics. We hired him. And then we, in the first years here, did a lot of what you see in the pictures here. We drove to Hamburg to try to install a microscope. So we came into a naked hutch with just some tables, and then we have to mount all our equipment up here. which was very hard and took a long time. Also, the detectors in those days were horrible. This was an image plate detector. So whenever we had taken a picture, you have to run to a special place to develop the image plate to be able to see what you're doing, and a lot of hand analysis. But the good thing is that we at least managed to prove the principles that we could see some grains and map a little bit of orientation. So we published that in 1995, the first paper we had. So the next big step was that we realized that this going to Hamburg and installing a setup from scratch is really not feasible, because it takes 3, 4, 5 days to install a line, and then maybe you have one night of measurements left. It doesn't work. You need a permanent installation. So what we did in those years was we had an agreement with ESF in France to hold a workshop where we could invite people. And I think some from the audience here were actually present in that workshop, where we try to discuss together with the management of ESF, what could such a 3D microscope be used for? Would it really, really be valuable? And luckily we were convincing enough, and they set aside a site here in the synchrotron where we could build a permanent installation for this 3D XRD type measurements. So that was step number two. Step number three was money. We were, at that time, we were sending this idea to one of the big funders in Denmark and managed to get over a 10-year period this amount of money, which is around 10 million euro, a little bit less than 10 million euro, which allowed us to hire enough people. I said before, Henning and I were starting this journey, but to do this, you need many more people. So you can see the original team here. And some of us with background in material science, other ones like Henning and Søren and Eric and Larry had backgrounds in physics, and in particular in X-ray physics, which was really needed for the setup. So with these three ingredients, it was, I would not say straightforward, but at least the way was ready to develop this instrument. We were having different designs, but the design that worked and is still working was that you have the ESF synchrotron out here. Then from that, from the optics, you choose just a monochromatic beam. And the good thing about X-rays from a synchrotron is it's very parallel beam. So a parallel beam comes in on the sample. It will diffract because it's very high energy. It will go all the way through. And it will diffract from all the grains that fulfill the Bragg condition with that wavelength and give a spot on a detector like this. You will then say, how do I know where the grain is inside the sample? And this we did by just having, in first place, we only had one detector that we moved forward and back, but now there's a whole range of detectors. And if you see the same diffraction pattern at different distances, you can just ray chase back and see where the grain is. And if you have the detector near, you will not see spots, you will see kind of footprints of your grain. So when you rotate your sample, you can reconstruct the whole 3D shape of the grain, a little bit like tomography. On the other hand, if you have the detectors far away, you can very quickly get orientation because you get a spot, and you can also measure strains. In the old days, when we started to work at ESF, this is what it looks like, looked like. Still a lot of mounting stuff. And in 2015, it looked like this. And in those early years, they were really hot years and fun years because we tried a lot of different things. And actually that gave a lot of science papers. That's typical for synchrotron. When you start something new, that's what they like. And you can publish it in the top journals. So for example, we have a paper here from one of our hosts, Eric Offerman, where they for the first time really could follow the phase, how the phases grew, actually doing a cooling experiment here, and found that one group of brains behaved like they should and a lot of others didn't. We ourselves did work on how the grains deform and how they rotate, how they grow when you recrystallize. And the group in England did stress corrosion cracking. So the good thing was they could see the crack by tomography and relate that to the microstructure. So this was, of course, nice. Lots of new things came out, and papers were rather easy to publish, I would say. But still, there were problems with the technique as it was then. When you come to deform grains, as soon as you start to deform your grains, the diffraction spots will spread out and it becomes very hard to reconstruct a 3D thing. So really the technique doesn't work so well for mapping deformed grains. It can easily find how the grains rotate, but it cannot map the deformed microstructure. And that was also a problem for the type of investigations that I led. And namely, when I see a grain growing, I didn't know what was around it. So when you have to interpret how the boundary was, it was hard. And for these type of measurements, a restriction is that you could not have too many grains, because then you get spot overlap and you cannot reconstruct the grains. So after that, Henning has continued to work on the development of the technique, and they were inspired by what we are also doing in microscopy, namely dark field microscopy, where you select a given diffraction vector and only look near that diffraction vector and get that to light up in your detector here. With that method, you can do what we did with the standard 3D XRD. You can get a map of the whole structure and its orientations with a resolution in the order of a few microns and a pretty good angular resolution. But if you go to the dark field mode, you can zoom in on specific grains. And in the ultimate case, you could go down to something like 300 nanometer and a very, very good angular resolution here. What is happening right now in France is that there's still cases where spot overlap is an issue. So they are working on making a smaller beam, incident beam, and then do point scanning on the sample. And they have managed now to get the beam down to a size of 60 nanometer, which of course is very challenging because just the slightest temperature variation, it's very warm in Denmark today, that would be a disaster, but they could reproduce 60 nanometer many, many times. So then you have a possibility to have a narrow beam and then scan your sample to avoid this spot overlap problem. At the time when we were working on our 3D XRD, a group led by Ben Larson and Jean Ice and the team, John Tisler at Oak Ridge and at APS, they worked on a different concept. Whereas we used a monochromatic beam, they decided that they want to use the white beam as the polychromatic beam, so they don't throw away any photons from their synchrotron. And then that let be incident on the sample in a small spot and diffract from there. They work generally at a little bit lower energy than us, so it's not quite as penetrating, but still it penetrates good into samples like aluminum and even in steel. With that set up, now, of course, because it's a white beam, you will get diffraction from all your grains that you will hit. So in order to find out where they are in the depth direction, what they did was they put in a wire in front of it. And what the wire does is that it will block the diffracted beam. So it's sitting between the sample and the detector, and it will be blocked. So when you are moving it forward, it will block some new X-rays and then subtracting the two detector images from each other, you can figure out exactly where your grain come from through the sickness, as is illustrated here. The spatial resolution of their technique was and still is around 200 nanometer with a very good lattice orientation resolution. And they can also measure strains down to 10 to the minus 4 delta D or D. So compared to our 3D XRD, they had a better spatial resolution, but much worse time resolution than we have, because it takes forever to move this wire in front of the sample. But it can map deformed grains, for example, up to 70% cold roll aluminum we have been able to look at. And the data analysis is much easier because they always work with this detector at a fixed position. Also at their side, something is happening there. The APS upgrade will lead to a much brighter undulator source that they will use for both to decrease the spot size and to increase the intensity, so the measurements will become quicker. Also, they are buying a new detector so they can look at more small spots. So that means the small grains in your samples. And they are, instead of just having a wire or a knife edge to move in front, they will make like a comb. So it will be a little bit more complicated, but then you can more quick get a good depth profile. So lots of things are happening there also. What we in my group are interested in now is, can we bring some of these methods to the home laboratory? The reason for that is that we can never match what you can do with a synchrotron. They are much higher intensity, many, many more photons. They're nice parallel beams, et cetera. But you can only get access when you apply or have a lot of money. Industries can generally, at most synchrotrons, buy beam time. But us from university, we have to apply. And what they like at synchrotrons is, of course, something that can give a new science paper or something like that. So the type of experiments that we often have to do, where you have to look at a range of materials and different processing parameters, different strains, different temperature, different impurities, whatever, is not very easy to get beam time for. And also, if you want to make really long experiments, or where you have to come back after, for example, a creep experiment after a certain time period, it's very, very hard to get appropriate beam time for. So what our dream now is can we do something in home? And for the basis for that, we are using X-ray microtomography, which of course you know what you can easily do is that you can put in your sample and you can see voids or particles inside the samples. But you can do more than that. And that's a technique that has been developed by Erik Lauritsen, who used to be in our group and now is the CEO of this company, Exnovo. So what they have thought of, actually based on also synchrotron work, is to put a beam stop in the middle here. So when you have your source that is shining X-rays from the laboratory source on the sample, it will penetrate and you will see those kind of images like tomography right in the middle. But if you block that off with the beam stop, you will see diffraction spots out here. They are faint, and that's why you need to block the direct beam information here. But if you are then clever, like they have been at this company here, it's very, very complicated because you have wide beam, they are not parallel, and you get spots from everything out here, and you will take the sample. But if you can do this software clever enough, you can reconstruct your grains. A limitation, though, is that at the moment, you cannot see small grains. Depending on which brochures you read, whether you can see grains smaller than 20 or 15 or 10 micron, I don't know. Generally, our experience with this machine is that it's very, very hard to see anything less than 15 micron. So we see there's a need for developing a technique where we can go down to 5 or 2 micron, and then the technique will be universal. It will never be fast. It will always be much slower than a synchrotron, but maybe it doesn't matter so much when you are working from home. And if you can go down to say 2 micron, you can probably also see deformed grains and you can also start to map strains. So we are trying to improve the spatial resolution. And so far we have taken 2 steps that I will illustrate. The first step is the following. See, like I said before, you have an X-ray source, you have your incoming beam here, which are not parallel, but in a cone shape. You get diffraction from your sample. But then if you put the detector at the same distance as there is from the source to the sample, and the same from the sample to the detector, of course you will get a focus. This is Lau focusing, so you'll get focus in this position here. But if you move the detector further away, you would of course magnify the signal from your grain, simple geometrical magnification. You will also blur your diffraction spots, but at least we try to see, could we take advantage of this? And the result is shown over here. What we are showing is it's a sample, it's an iron sample, and we measure it first at the synchrotron, which we consider the ground truth. It cannot be measured better than that in 3D. So here we are illustrating 2 grains, one large 160 micron and a small 145 micron. And then we measured in this column here, we are showing what we measure in the standard Lauer setup. And here we are measuring if we just increase the distance. Here there was 13 millimeter between the source and the sample, and also 13 millimeter here, whereas here we change it so there's 11 millimeter here and 18 millimeter here. So it's not a big change, but just a change. And you can see the result. It's going in the right direction for the big brain, but actually for the big brains, lapplicity is doing a good job. Whereas when you go to the smaller grains, you can see here it's quite wrong, whereas the agreement when you magnify is getting much better. So the conclusions we had was that when we increase to, instead of having a 1-to-1 ratio to 1.6 ratio, you can see grains down to actually 7 micron, where before we could only see grains to 7 micron. And the spatial resolution were going up to factors as high as 7.3 for the small grains. So that was step number one. Step number two is that we are also trying to use artificial intelligence. And the reason why we were motivated to go into artificial intelligence looking at this particular problem here was that when you see self-driving cars, it's amazing what they can do. They can find cats and dogs and people on the street and the balloons flying around and of course all the other cars. So then I thought it should be a piece of cake for this artificial intelligence to try to find these spots in a essentially black and white pattern. So this should be very, very easy. What is the trick in artificial intelligence is what is illustrated here. first you have to define the task. That was easy for us. We just want to find the spots, or actually to reduce the background so it's easy to find the spots. Then we have to collect data. That's also easy because we're using this machine a lot. So we have lots of diffraction patterns. Then comes the next one that says training here. And in most of the training that are being used for the systems that are used out there, it has been a person that has sit there and pointed at cars and whatever you have on the streets or what he's looking at. We didn't want that. I'll come back to that. And then when you have done that, then the system itself, you set up a model where you don't tell anything. So the model is guessing blind to try to find what it should. And then when it's training, then when it's comparing with the training, it finds out it's wrong. And then it refines its model and it continues in this loop until you get a good model that can actually find your cars and your scooters and what else you have. And from there on, it's just to maintain the routine to get it going. So we wanted to avoid this training. I don't think I could find any professor or student or technician or anybody that wants to sit and look at many, many images like this and pinpoint all the little individual spots here. And in the training, it's actually very important that you don't forget the spots. If you just take a few of them, we try that. It doesn't work. So it screws up completely. It has to be very precise in how you train to get it to work. So the idea that we got was that we could simulate, if you take a virtual sample and just let the x-rays shine on it virtually in the computer, you can calculate where you would find the diffraction spots and how they would look. This is rather straightforward. And then we added noise, like we measure experimentally. So just measure without the sample and take a lot of noise patterns that they essentially look like that. Then we put them together. So that's like a virtual input. So we take this virtual input here, fit it into this net where we use something that's called a U-net. They have lots of different nets and you need some experts to tell you which is a good way to start. It doesn't matter so much, but to save time. Then this network predicts something and then it takes what they call a loss network, which is just least square fitting essentially, an advanced least square fitting procedure here that compares what it predicts to the truth. So our truth is this one. This is the one that we have labeled, we have trained. So it compares what it predicts to what it should do. And then it does that many, many times to refine the thing. And you can see how the loss, as how this fit becomes better and better, both in frozen where you fix some parameters and then when you let it be free in the end. And at a certain stage, you see that no more training would improve the thing. And then that's it. That's when you are satisfied with the model. So how did it work for our system? Here we have the experimental input in black and white, and here we just showed it in color just to the fun of it. Here we show our what's coming out of the deep learning routine, also in color here. But it's more illustrated maybe in these plots here. Here we just follow the intensity along this line, the diagonal line and a horizontal line. And the red curve in this graph is the experiment, and the blue curve is what comes out of the deep learning. And as you can see very clearly, now it's much, much, much easier because if you have some tiny little peaks here drowning in noise, you are kind of lost. But when you have this background here, you can easily find the peaks. And altogether we found we could improve the identification of the peak for something like 20%. So that means that we are now down to see something like 5 micrograins altogether, I would say. This was the first part. Now I go to the scientific parts. So there I will talk about recrystallization and I will talk about results that we got with 3D and 4D. And I will try to both take some of the first experiments we've done. So many of you have maybe heard them, but this is really to try to put things into perspective. What did we learn from the first one and where are we now? And I will also try to tie relations to simulations in wherever it's relevant. And I will cover all the specs, kinetics, nucleation growth, and also some of the new stuff we are working on local strain distributions. Start with kinetics. The reason why we started with kinetics and also why I put it first here is this is really easy. And when you start to work with a new technique like the 3D XRD, you better start with something simple. So the experiment is super simple. You have your X-ray beam coming in and hitting your sample that's sitting in a furnace here. And then you have a detector sitting in the back. The beam goes all the way through. You rotate the sample to see all the grains and you record patterns. So in the deformed state, you will see your debye sharings that are textured, like you see them here. And when the sample starts to recrystallize, you would see spots appearing here. And by integrating the intensity over the spots, subtracting the background, you can convert that to the size of the grains, and you can follow how they grow. So you typically get curves like this, where you see the grain radius as a function of annealing time at a given temperature here. And the message that we got, which was somewhat surprising to us at that time, was that you have a whole range of growth rate. There's not two grains that behave the same. We advanced that a little bit some years later. You can still see it's many years ago. There we, in the middle of the run, changed the temperature. And the reason why you do that is that if you change the temperature and just use a very simple equation, you can calculate what is the activation energy. We did that, and you could find what that the activation energy were all over the place, all the way from zero. We didn't find any negative, but we find it from zero and all the way up. The good thing was the average was where it was expected for this material, this temperature, etc. But it's all over the place. So we discussed that a bit, and it could be, at least it was suggested, that maybe that is what David Olmsted and Liz Holm and Stephen Foyles were seeing with the MD simulations. What they showed in nickel, working with a synthetic driving force, looking at specific boundaries, was that some boundaries behave like they should, as a Heenius type thermal activated process. What they're showing here is the mobility as a function of, it's actually, they write down here 1/over temperature, but it is temperature. This, you can see the axis is turned the other way around. So it's quite tricky when you read the paper to keep your mind straight. But here it is as a function of temperature. So you can see the mobility goes up with higher temperature. But they also find a good group of grains where they, here they plot it the normal way, where they have temperature, high temperature here, low temperature there, and the mobility, and they see that the mobility goes down. So they suggested that the reason why we see all these variations could be because of reactions like this. Personally, I believe it might be an effect, but added to that, for us, we are looking at recrystallization. So our grains see the deformed microstructure, and that will change from time to time. So sometimes the grain will see something nice to grow into, sometimes they will see something bad to grow into. So I still believe this is a major reason for why we are seeing this variation. Next, nucleation. I guess I will not bet on which nucleation mechanisms are active, and I will not bet on where the nuclei come still. So we have studied that a lot all over the world, but to really say where and why, pinpoint that before you start to anneal, that will be a challenge. Yet we know that there are a lot of nucleation mechanisms which no doubt works. Particle stimulated nucleation, strain-induced boundary migration, subgrain coalescence, subgrain growth, etc. They surely work. But again, for example, if you look at strain-induced boundary migration, where on a boundary would the nuclei come? Yeah. Now, anyway, with this one, the first thing we looked into was that if you look at all these mechanisms, they will all lead to orientations of the nuclei which are similar to where they were formed. So for example, here, this nuclei will have an orientation that was in the deformed state over here somewhere. But in literature, there was a whole range of papers that were saying that also nuclei with new orientations couldn't develop. Now we heard about it at the ICOTOM conference from the group from Poland. They are finding a lot of those. What we did in those days was, again, we wanted to use the 3D-XRD. And whereas when you take 2D methods to find new orientation, it's of course horrible because you never know if the nuclei come below the surface. So when you look at the surface and something comes up, you can never say whether it's a new orientation because it could have been there below the surface. And if you do static measurements looking in the bulk of a sample that has been annealed a little bit, of course, the evidence is lost, like Brian Doggan said back in one of the early texture conferences, because you do not see what was there before the nuclei formed. But with the 3D-XRD technique, it's the easiest nucleation to look at, actually, because again, like we said before, we can start from something that is deformed, and then we can anneal it. Here we looked at a smaller region. This is the deformed state. And then when you start to anneal, new spots come up, which are away from where they were before, like you see them there. And then you can find out where they are, and you can find out what orientations they have. in those days, we worked with this detection limit. So there could have been in the deformed microstructure things with an orientation similar to the new one, which was smaller than that. But actually, since this sample is aluminum, pure aluminum, and only rolled to a small strain, most cells are of this size. So I guess we are picking most of them up. What we found was that nuclei with new orientations were these ones. You can see a lot of the ones that I shown in blue here, they're actually on the surface. And that was because the sample was cut and maybe not grinded or polished or taken care of well enough. So nuclei came from the surface. But there are also a few ones in the bulk, the ones that are shown here. They do not touch the surface, so they are not originated from surface scratches, and they were on new orientations. And the conclusions we got out of it was that it's not random orientations they come with, but they actually relate to the misorientations in the parent deformation microstructure. But the problem again is we could not, with these early measurements, map the deformation microstructure. Yet we have done in some more recent work there, we have taken it to APS, where they had the best resolution in microstructure. We took a sample, again, pure aluminum, this time rolled only 12%, but then we put a hardness indent in the top to stimulate nucleation. The reason for that is that if you don't know where your nuclei come, you can easily spend many days, APS time, on mapping a large area, and then when you anneal it, no nuclei form. Typically, in something like a day, you can maybe map 50 by 50 by 50 micron or something like that. So you can easily risk that you have spent a day or two and you get no nuclei. So we wanted to play it as safe as we could, and therefore we made this hardness indent, and we did a lot of homework to find out that we do get nuclei coming with this magnitude of the hardness indent. And it did. So when we annealed this sample that we characterized carefully first, where you clearly see the effect of the hardness indent and you see the deformation microstructure, we also get nuclei, they are here. Then we can start to analyze what orientation relationships do this nuclei have to what was there before in the matrix. And in this particular case, no new orientations. All of them was coming up with parent orientation, like we're showing here. What we have with the black dot is the nuclei orientation, and what we see in the cloud are the orientations that were there at the position of the nuclei before the annealing. And that was the case for all the something like 30 nuclei that we looked at. They all came with parent orientation. But that means when they come with parent orientation, we can also identify the embryonic volume of where the nuclei come from. It's just to look for the same orientation in the deformed state. Here we illustrate that. Here we just, instead of showing it in 3D, we just show different layers, different sections in the deformed and in the annealed state. And you could see that the nuclei, there was 3 pixels or voxels with exactly this orientation before the annealing. So it's very likely that these are the embryonic volume of this nuclei. And that was the case. We could do that for all of them. Then as a next step, we could relate these nucleation sites to the stored energies. We are showing it here in 3D and in some 2D sections here. And the conclusion is that all our nuclei come where there's high stored energy, but there's a lot of similar magnitude high stored energy where no nuclei are forming. This is what we are saying here. We also found that the viable nuclei, the one that has grown, are partly surrounded by high energy boundaries, larger than 10 degrees. And we suggested that maybe the nucleation mechanism was strain-induced dislocation boundary migration. This is a single crystal, so there are no original grain boundaries in this particular sample. But this one here kind of points our attention to when we have to make a model predicting nuclei, it's not enough just to say, let's put nuclei in where there's high stored energy. We need more. And that we investigated together with Roman K from Saint-Etienne in France. From Julian, when he was alive, we got a very nice tricrystal that we could section, and presumably each section should be very close, almost identical. We rolled them 40%, the slices, and 2 neighboring slices. One of them we subsequently annealed to part recrystallization. And what we are showing here is just a view where we just see 2 of the crystals, the crystal B and the crystal A, just in this plane here. So you see different microstructures. You see this microstructure in the deformed state of crystal A is much more subdivided than over here. And when we are near, we see the nuclei. Here we show the nuclei on a blue background. So this is just where no nuclei form, all the light blue here, but the nuclei form in some bundles like you see it here. So we try to relate that to the stored energies. We just took a box moving along, and we could see that if we start from a given position, that the stored energy profile was like this, while the density of nuclei in crystal A was going like this. So again, stored energy is not a good measure. So we suggested that we should come up with, call it an efficient or primary, or whether we're going to call it stored energy, the one that can lead to nucleation, which should be a function of the general stored energy multiplied with some factor that are taking the anisotropy of the orientation distribution into account. And with Roman's very detailed analysis of the different disorientations around the major axis, it's not the Rodriguez, but it's another type that they are generally using that he did also together with Dawson. But it is essentially just misorientations around different axes. And what he could find is that actually, when you look at this profile here, it fits much better with the disorientation of the primary rotation axis. And that led us to suggest that this efficient stored energy could be given by the normal stored energy times a function here, and then we get a very good match for this one crystal that we have investigated so far. We are putting a new PhD student to work on this and see if an equation like this would help us to be better in predicting nucleation for also other systems than the one that we looked at here. Two more stories, which are not quite as long, and then I'm done. So growth, boundary migration. Of course, the big question is what's really going on when the boundary is moving. The first measurements we did that was also published in the first one was published in the Science paper, and we did one more. And what we always found was that the growth is very complex. It's not homogeneous, and the shape of the grain is funny with arms shooting out here and there for no obvious reasons when you cannot see the deformed microstructure. That led us to study much more the roughness of the recrystallization boundary, because I guess the picture that we get from textbook is a recrystallizing grain is nice and round and smooth. But actually, when you look in literature, even very old literature, it has always been there. This is the classical paper on SIBM. See how rough the boundary is. Other papers, the boundaries are always rough, which at least I had not noticed that people had paid much attention to before all these in situ measurements came about. So that led us to suggest again that when we look at the driving force for motion of the boundary, we should include a curvature driving force, just like we do in grain growth. You have to include whenever you have protrusions, retrusions on the boundary. Going then to in situ or ex situ investigations of the real boundary migration, we again took a sample to APS where they could well resolve the deformed microstructure. And we measured in different annealing steps. So you have a recrystallizing grain here and you have the deformed microstructure here. First step, if you just look at the deformed ones, you can see that the recrystallized grain has had some flat plateaus, then a curved boundary, then another flat, then curved, then flat again. So it's kind of shaped like this. And then when you anneal, it moves so that the deformed microstructure goes away, like you can see it here. And if you plot how far the grain has grown, it has not moved anything here. It has moved quite a bit on the curved part, not so much on the plateau curved part, not so much here. And then you can relate that to all the parameters that we know. So why do some parts move and other parts not move? Again, using our equation, and we actually put in the curvature as well, but it didn't help. So what we see is that if we take the stored energy in front of the moving parts and in front of the non-moving parts in the two steps of anneal that we did, it's in the same ballpark. It's a little bit higher for the moving parts, but it's not very big difference to the non-moving ones. Also, when we take the misorientation distribution for the moving parts and the non-moving parts in the two annealing steps, I don't see a difference. This is the same. Then we did MD simulations. That was Eric Homer from Brigham Young who did the investigations. So he took three boundaries with the same misorientation, the one we are having, but with different grain boundary plane normals. And this is, of course, one of the important things that you get out extra of the 3D measurements. So what he has here is this are the flat parts that don't move, and 2 and 3 are within the cloud of the curved parts that move. And what he's then showing here is the mobility that you are finding. So if we see the moving part, this number 2 seems to be good moving here, but number 3, which is very close and also included, doesn't move. This one that really the part of the boundary that does not move is in between the mobility values of the ones that move. So again, that is not a simple explanation that the grain boundary plane normal is determining the growth. So for us, again, that led us to the conclusion that it's really the deformation microstructure that plays a very important role. The way the dislocation boundaries are arranged relative to the migrating boundary is super important. I'm running out of time, but again, the main point here is that the morphology of the deformation microstructure is important. So now we are doing some phase field simulations together with Nele Molens and Vishal Yadav. We are at first doing some idealized thing where we put in an idealized microstructure inspired by what we are seeing really with 2 sets of GNBs. And then we are putting a recrystallized grain in that moves from this side, and you can see where the boundary should be. So what it has some low energies here and some high energies here. And when you see a grain growing, the position of the boundary will become very rough. So at least that makes sense for what we have suggested before. And also when you look at mobilities, it moves faster in certain direction relative to the form microstructure than, for example, in this direction, which could also match what we are seeing. But this is like idealized things. Next step, we are really going to do a one-to-one experimental simulation comparison with the phase field simulations, and we will see what it comes out with. But there are 2 more jokers in this game that I think we have to look into. And one is that we have found that inside the recrystallized grains, in a partly recrystallized samples, there are also dislocation boundaries. I think we all know that there will still be a few dislocations inside the recrystallized grains. They're not totally perfect, even though we generally say so, but they are not 100% perfect. But what surprised me was that these actually are still arranged in some kind of boundaries, like you can see it on this sketch here. What we are showing is the misorientation, if you follow the blue line, and you can see the misorientations are small, very small, but that you have an order structure like that, that seems also somewhat to relate to the roughness of the boundary, is an intriguing point that I think we have to investigate further. And residual strains. What Juul-Jensen has been doing, he has been looking at recrystallizing grain, again, in partly recrystallized samples. Here it's a iron sample that has been cold rolled 50% and then yield to 58% recrystallization. So he has mapped that at APS. And he has mapped the residual strains inside the grains. Here are the different components. And you see huge strains. You see strains up to almost 10 to the minus 4 in the recrystallized grains. And again, you can sometimes find that these retrusions are related to either high compressive strains or strains. So I would say also the residual strains probably have to be taken into account. You can also see this paper that's already published. My very last slides is again related to strains, because now we talked about strains in the recrystallized microstructure, but there are surely also strains in the deformed microstructure, and they're probably even more important. So we also need to get a handle on them. And what we are investigating, that we are doing at home in this machine that I told you. So we are taking Masakazu Kobayashi has brought an aluminium copper sample where there's a lot of particles in. And that we can see by tomography, by the normal diffraction, we can see the grains. Then we can do in situ tensile deformation, and we can follow how the particles move, and therefore we can measure locally the strains inside the grains. This is what we got. What we are showing here is only the central part where there should be no problems with grips, etc. We can see the initial orientation of the grains, and then we can see how the strain develop up to close to where the sample breaks. And what we see is a big variation. Some grains have very high strains. Other grains have far less equivalent strains. There's a big scatter in it. We are trying to relate that to simulations where we are doing crystal plasticity finite element simulations together with Roman, idealizing the structure here into some things like mesh structure like this, and then calculating. And we are right in the moment of now analyzing and see how this thing agrees. Generally, it agrees. The strains come out to be of the right magnitude, but when you compare one-to-one, more analysis are needed to understand what's going on, and this we are in the progress of doing. But my main message of putting this part also into the presentation today is that the strain field and stress field are nowhere near homogeneous in our samples. So we should also try to get a handle on that in our modeling of recrystallization. So my conclusion slide is, I think future 3D and 4D characterizations will benefit significantly from ongoing upgrades of the simple techniques, and I hope that we can soon do a lot of it in the labs. I think for recrystallization, we have learned a lot by the new methods, and the main message is that we have to take the deformation-induced microstructural variations into account in the future modeling of recrystallization, and local residual strains are likely to be of utmost importance too. So with that, thank you very much for your attention, and sorry for talking 3 minutes too much than I planned. Thanks.
Thank you. Dorte.